the wrestling world in shock today. Former champion Chris Benoit found dead in his Atlanta home along with his wife and young son. Police now treating the discovery as a double murder-suicide.
A shocking find at a downtown Minneapolis hotel.
The body of World Wrestling Entertainment star Eddie Guerrero.
And how there's drugs and there's steroids in this business. And they need to, I think Vince needs to definitely enforce the drug policy more than what he's doing.
On July 22nd, 2008, WWE officially transitioned all of their programming to PG, meaning that all of their television shows and pay-per-views would hold less shock value and contain themes that parents may deem suitable for their young children. The move came after longtime WWE superstar Chris Benoit killed himself, his wife, and son in a double homicide in June of 2007. The incident left the mainstream media painting WWE in a very poor light, and after the death, there was much more finger-pointing that went on questioning WWE's integrity. A small time before that, WWE instituted a wellness policy after a steroid scandal and the death of fan favorite Eddie Guerrero, who passed away at age 38. The other reason as to why the company went PG was that CEO Linda McMahon was leaving her position in the company and running for Connecticut Senate. So WWE had to clean up their act. A show like what they were putting out wouldn't be fitting a potential senator. The gruesome violence, presentation of women, themes, and overall subject matter was one which many people found inappropriate. So the McMahons spent $50 million on Linda's Senate campaign and donated another $8 million to universities for grants. But the campaign was unsuccessful. Even though Linda lost, WWE still believed that they had to clean up their act and the PG rating stayed. What WWE also wanted was to entice wrestling in general, as fans were seen as cheap and having no brand loyalty. Oftentimes you'd see WWE on random ads for things such as acne medication. So 2008 came and the shift to PG programming was underway. This is what many fans believe was the downfall of the product that they once loved. But before we delve into the now, we have to go back to the past. It was October 19th, 1999, where WWF went from a private company to a publicly traded company, meaning that the company sold ownership in its business to individual investors or investment firms. Why did they do this, you might ask? Well, they offered stock so that they could build capital to expand into different avenues aside from just the in-ring and touring aspect, so that the company would reduce risk of losing its money and the money invested into their company in the form of selling ownership could be translated to different media ventures. If we know anything about Vince McMahon, it's that he's a businessman before all else. We'd seen his failures with the Ico Pro supplements and the World Bodybuilding Federation, but once the company went public, we saw McMahon try to grow the WWF brand even more. We saw the company open up WWF New York, trying to combat the WCW Nitro Grill. Turns out, putting a restaurant in Times Square isn't the most profitable business decision, and by April of 03, that restaurant was shut down, and it cost Vince $25 million. We saw Vince McMahon try to launch his own football league, the XFL, which cost him and NBC $35 million. WWE Studios and WWE Niagara Falls weren't the success that they thought they would be. Point is, before trying to be a wrestling company, WWF wanted to get into mainstream touring and the retail business. You see, at this time, the company was in its most popular time frame, known as the Attitude Era, a time period between 1997 and 2002, where if you linked wrestling to just about anything, it would sell.
Yes. We always use sex to enhance our image.
You know, as athletes, we couldn't give a monkey's ass about being good role models.
This was a time where the World Wrestling Federation had an emphasis on relying on sexual themes, shock value, coarse language, and a more mid-teen to adult-oriented approach. A time where the crowds were the loudest, storylines and characters were the most compelling, and the wrestling business was at its height. Following that era, the company rebranded from the World Wrestling Federation to World Wrestling Entertainment, following a lawsuit with the World Wildlife Fund over the WWF trademark in 2002. And the WWE went from this extremely sexual, barbaric, and shock value-driven attitude era to a bit more toned down, but still controversial, ruthless aggression era. Many of the characters from the previous time frame were gone or on a part-time basis, and the popularity of wrestling was down from the previous period. It was during this time where the Benoit incident took place, and after that, the failed Senate run and other allegations, McMahon knew that he had to adapt or his company would be left outside the greater entertainment world with so much controversy already surrounding them. And that's where we come today, the PG rating for WWE programming. We have seen some of the worst angles and segments during this time frame. The Muppets, a commentator thinking he was Super Cena, 47.5 million Raw guest hosts, Natalya Neidhart, Little People's Court, a computer being the general manager of a nationally broadcast television show. Truly some of the worst television in the history of television. This is what many fans say ruined WWE. Everything they once loved was gone, and they were left with a shell of what the company once was. So did PG really kill WWE as a whole? The first thing wrestling fans immediately point their fingers to is declining ratings. You can attribute terrible ratings to the downfall of television overall, but did the audience really tune out as much as people say they did? Well, since 1993, WWE's premier TV program has been Monday Night Raw. And for this video, we're gonna use Raw as the benchmark. The heights for this TV show came in the late 90s, where they scored numbers topping out at 8.1 million viewers. Before we get to the ratings, we have to understand them first. In the US and Canada, ratings are done through a company called Nielsen. The company gets households to become part of their data sampling program, and those households are known as Nielsen families. They then install meters in these homes to measure how programming is watched, what age bracket it's watched by, and how long it's watched. They then take those numbers and extrapolate them to give advertisers information on who is watching what. How accurate are these numbers? They're not accurate. Not at all. Numbers represent a small portion of a general audience which is actually watching the said programming. All ratings truly are is an estimate of how many people are watching a certain show at a certain time. But for the purposes of this video, let's use 5-year increments from 2000 to see the drop off in Raw's rating. In the year 2000, Raw was averaging 5.87 million. 5 years later, come 2005, that 5.8 went down to a 4.8. Come 2010, WWE's flagship TV show was down to a 3.28 and then dipped even further to 2.64 with the addition of a third hour. By 2020, Monday Night Raw's average viewership fell to 1.87 million, a drop of about 4 million viewers over a 20-year period. If you look at Raw's decline overall the past few years against the top 50 non-news cable programs, you can see that Raw's decline is massive. In 2020, it went down over 20%. SmackDown, it's a little bit more gradual. That's because it's on a much stronger network. Even if you go by single years from 1999 to 2003, you'll see that the TV numbers for Raw were already declining. Roughly losing about a million viewers every 5 years for Raw since 2000, but they're still getting TV deals. Why? Well, live sports always do better than something like a sitcom or a movie. Consumers choose to watch sports and professional wrestling live more often than not. And because WWE continues to rank fairly high in key demographics, advertisers see WWE as a hot commodity ticket. That's one of the critical reasons as to why a third hour was added to Raw. USA Network saw it as lucrative when it came to potential advertising and revenue. Even though historically Raw's third hour has seen a high drop-off rate, but still, USA benefits from putting a bidding war on advertising time. Fans always criticize Raw's falling ratings, but for WWE, that doesn't really matter. As long as they maintain these numbers, they have guaranteed income. WWE's deal to broadcast Monday Night Raw on USA pays them $265 million a year until 2024. The WWE on Fox deal pays the company $205 million per year until 2024 as well. Add to that WWE gets approximately $45 to $50 million for two shows a year over a 10-year stretch in the form of Saudi Arabia specials, and financially, they're set. Where the issue comes in and where they're losing fans is the actual substance of the programming. Each year, more and more fans tune out of the show. Why? Because WWE cannot create a cast of characters to get them intrigued. Let's go back to when I was a kid. For our generation, it was Eddie Guerrero, John Cena, Lesnar, Batista, Randy Orton. The generation before us, The Rock, Stone Cold, Triple H, Mankind, Mr. McMahon. Before them, it was HBK, Bret Hart, Undertaker, Razor Ramon. A cast of characters which had us hooked and wanting to see what they would do. The drama, the antics, the over-the-top stories, they just transcended the game. You look at how WWE hasn't been able to build new stars, it's a testament as to why fans stopped watching. There's literally one guy right now that brings intrigue. One guy. WWE has missed the boat on stars who the fans want to embrace and want to see on that next level. Eric Bischoff put it best.
I think that WWE has done a great job over the last 15 years, 20 years of making WWE the star, and the talent is a supporting cast member.
That really says it all. Give me a reason to care and I'll make time to watch your programming. Wrestling has kind of lost that cool factor if you really think about it. Once you hit a certain age, fans are tuning out. They aren't creating as many of those second and third generation fans who are going to pass on the tradition of watching wrestling. Oftentimes, it's one and done. Kids become adults, and as adults, they see WWE as a program for kids. Those same fans that WWE could have had for a longer period of time go somewhere like the UFC, which has gained a lot of momentum with teenagers. Doesn't help that your writers don't even know the talent's name. Another reason as to why fans tuned out is it's more easy to consume content than ever. You look on social media, shows are recapped in seconds. Why would you want to sit through 2 or 3 hours if you can just watch a 10-minute highlight video on YouTube? Consumption of media has changed. People are cutting cords and not as many people watch primetime television anymore. In the US, consumption of television is declining as you can see. Add to that, that WWE just has too much content. They have 7 plus hours of shows on a weekly basis with Raw, SmackDown, Main Event, NXT, and more. It's very hard for the company to keep things unique with that much programming. But does that give them an excuse to produce the content they do? Hell no. SmackDown has been a show which has always been PG. Only issue is that PG in the early 2000s was the equivalent to TV-14. WWE right now is probably TVG more than anything else. But why don't they push the envelope a little bit more? If you think about it, there's a lot that they could do with a TVPG rating. If I had to take an educated guess, it's probably because we live in a world of political correctness and everything is overanalyzed at every turn. There's someone sitting behind their keyboard just waiting to cancel your TV show. The problem goes a bit deeper than just TV figures though. We've seen full-on pockets of arenas during pay-per-views completely tarped up because no one bought tickets. Monday Night Raw is half empty, venues basically bribing people to go watch WWE with 2-for-1 tickets. That is because live event figures are down. Consumers are not wanting to go watch WWE events as much as they once did. Here you can see that WWE live events account for about 10% of WWE's overall revenue, and each year, the amount of money they make from live events gets smaller. If you take out the pandemic year of 2020 and you look at WWE's paid attendance since 2017, it's down by 29%. If you want to gauge popularity even more, then you can look at something like Google Web Search, which has been down by 61% since 2017. The interest in WWE's product is plateauing, and it's being seen as a casual event more than ever. Oh look, WWE's in town. You got a few hours to kill? Yeah, let's go. So you may ask, if people aren't coming to events as much as they once did, how does WWE make money? Well, do you guys remember in 2014, WWE launched this thing called the WWE Network, having everything from prank shows, documentaries, and all the wrestling you could possibly want. Vince McMahon and WWE themselves saw that they had to cannibalize the pay-per-view model and get into the growing video-on-demand world. The venture cost WWE $66 million to start up. The network had varying success and would see dips in subscribers after WrestleMania season and on a yearly basis overall. So in 2021, NBC Universal streaming service Peacock acquired the rights to distribute WWE Network's content. The deal got WWE $1 billion. Here in Canada, that right is given to Rogers Sports and Entertainment for both the network and broadcasting all weekly shows on Sportsnet. WWE Studios is something that you guys might be familiar with, and despite what many people lead you to believe, the studio is actually very successful at pulling WWE in money. That production company has deals with Netflix, A&E, and Universal to distribute content. You guys know how they're always advertising Ms. and Mrs., Total Bellas, or some animated film they have coming up? That's because that racks them in a ton of money. It's actually really strange if you look at it. The wrestling world has completely changed. First, wrestling events would be on free TV, and it was basically a commercial to get people into live events. Then, at live events, it became about selling merch. Then it turned to pay-per-view buys and attendance numbers, and after that, they made it about streaming the WWE Network. Now it's mainly all TV deals and letting your content be filtered to other companies or services. Why do they get so much money? Well, they're well respected and trusted in the community, and they've locked away all mentions to what I started this video with. WWE used to make most of its money selling things directly to consumers, like tickets to shows, pay-per-views, DVDs, magazines, and action figures. Now, WWE makes most of its money selling things to other businesses. As you can see, each year that number is getting larger. Why is it getting larger? Well, the TV rights world has exploded. Social media sponsorships. If you look at the other end in terms of live events, pay-per-views, and home entertainment, that number is projected to have a large dip in the coming years as everything shifts over to social media and heavy advertising. It kind of makes sense, right? They don't have to give you, the hardcore consumer, a good in-ring product as long as these financials match up and investors are happy. Most of these investors could care less about wrestling. The dollar signs are the only thing that matters. And without them going PG, that would have never been able to happen. Look at their yearly revenue from 2015 to 2020. The 2020 number probably would have been larger if they were touring. Another huge chunk of their revenue is social media, and the platform you're watching this video on right now, YouTube. WWE over its social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, has over 1 billion followers. On YouTube, they rank in the top 10 most subscribed YouTube channels. The company makes an estimated $45.8 million yearly in terms of YouTube revenue. Media advertisements like Snickers, KFC, Cricket Wireless, The Works. If you look into WWE's annual reports, you'll see that each year their social media engagement is increasing, and the company pushes hard for that. They are not a wrestling company. They are a media and entertainment company. In 2004, they said they were aggressively looking to push into that market. In a way, WWE plucked themselves out of becoming an afterthought and became one of the world's most profitable companies. But since they're making this much money, it also raises a huge question. Why are they firing people despite being in the best financial position they ever have? Ever since WWE named Nick Khan president and chief revenue officer, the company has slashed contracts, which raises the question of a possible sale. The thing about the cuts is they're all pretty random if you look at it. If you want to re-baseline your company, logic would suggest that you do so with cheaper and less proven commodities. But those cheaper contracts seem to be the ones which the company is letting go. With that, they've also let top merchandise shippers such as Bray Wyatt just leave. When a company clears the cupboard like that, so to speak, it has eyes rolling. Could WWE be sold? Rumors would suggest companies like Disney, NBC, and Comcast have led the way when it comes to those discussions, but if the company were to sell, it would be a very slippery slope. Look, as much as people may hate WWE, the way they do business, their storylines, their relationship with the Saudi government, wrestlers need places to work. Let me put it to you like this. If a wrestling company is owned by a corporation that gives no shit about wrestling, it will do away with WWE's past and just keep pushing into the media area, which is where the money is. Currently, WWE owns an extremely extensive tape library. Everything from NWA, Crockett, Stampede, Mid-South, the Attitude Era. If another corporation were to buy WWE, the history of WWE would die away. And that's why a sale to a company like Disney would be one of the worst moves ever. Just look at WWE on Peacock. The amount of censorship, how inaccessible they've made certain things, the past is already dying. It really is something to be scared about. So, to conclude, did WWE going PG kill the company as much as fans speculate that it did? The answer is yes. Interest in the product is at an all-time low. The numbers show a decline, and more fans are turning to All Elite Wrestling, which has cut into Vince McMahon's long-standing monopoly over the wrestling business. Here's the thing. Everything WWE did in the Attitude Era was cool, but at the end of the day, it was unsustainable. You could argue that anything the company did after 2001 onwards didn't work. Wrestling lost its coolness, and once we got to about the mid-2000s, the aura really wore off. So fans who were gonna tune out anyways were already gone. The move to PG, however, was the smartest business decision the company ever made. After so much controversy, they cleaned up their act and became trusted among mainstream media. The PG rating allowed more fans to tune into the show. They try to appeal to everyone. They base their ideology, their business model, and their shows for the casual consumer. And of course, children. It's a business. You appeal to the demographic that will keep you afloat, and for them, that is kids. Shock value wears off. Things like chair shots and adult themes had become commonplace. Now when they happen, they feel bigger and there's more intrigue. The company, though, was able to make a global expansion, and if they didn't go PG, they would not be able to. Is this company overhated? Without a doubt. But if you bleed everything together, at the end of the day, it's a business, and the company is killing it where it matters. WWE already has a built-in hardcore audience to the point where they'll be fine, unless, you know. But I want to hear from you guys. What do you think? Do you guys think PG was the downfall of the wrestling product? Let me know in the comments below. As always, do take very good care of yourself. Bye.